That is the question. Whether to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous errors, or take arms against and by opposing end them. My boss decided to have a little fun with Shakespeare, and now I have to deal with his poetry. So my name is Sean Dunn. I am an Enterprise Agile Coach with IHS. I work for Todd Little, who's VP Product Development at IHS, and what I'm going to talk about today is some research that we did on estimating, and specifically the value of estimates versus no estimates. And in doing so, we collaborated with Chris Verhoef from VRI University in Amsterdam. I was actually just a minor player in this whole act. However, Todd was unable to be here today, so I am taking his place. So I'd like to start off with a little bit of audience participation. How many in the room today consider it part of their job to either create estimates or deliver on someone else's estimates? Hands up if that applies to you. I think that's the majority of people in the room. So this will be very interesting or important to you, as it kind of determines how successful you will be in doing that. So I fell into software and software engineering because I like solving problems. I like exploring the unknown, solving things that haven't been solved before. And that's basically how we add value. And it's sometimes difficult to try and, there's this quote, it's difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on him not understanding it. But that's exactly the problem we face in software. We start off not knowing something and then having to solve the problem. And so when someone comes up and asks you, how long is this going to take? We hear this all the time. How long is this going to take? How long will this take? What answer do you give? There's what everybody wants to hear, right? Which is this nice, you know, if this is actuals versus estimates, this is highly deterministic, you know, we're really certain that this is the answer. There's not going to be a lot of risk involved. But what has reality taught most of us, right? That there are a million or an infinite number of things that can go wrong because it hasn't been done before. So reality is that there's this really long tail, right? There's kind of a limited short amount of, we can only make things go so fast, but there's an infinite number of things that can potentially go wrong that can extend things for long periods of time, longer than we thought. So our actuals versus estimates actually tend to follow more of this curve here. And this is actually roughly approximated from research by Todd and DeMarco. So when someone asks you this question, what answer do you give? Do you give them what they want to hear? Do you give them the median, the number that occurs most often? Do you give them the mean or the 50 percentile? Or do you give them the high confidence, the P90, the 90th percentile, the number we're more sure about? And when you give an answer, do you know this is the answer you're giving? Does the person who hears it know that that's the answer we're receiving? Do we have that conversation? Or do we just give the one and only number without any context of what it means? So there is risk in software development. There has to be. Without risk, there is no value. If we were building something that had already been built before by someone else, we would know exactly how long it would take, but there'd be absolutely no point in doing it. So this uncertainty and risk is this inevitable part of product development. So what do we estimate? What are some things we estimate? Any suggestions? What are some things we estimate? Size, right? So, okay, we estimate in time, we estimate in size, and release. We're at the start of a start of a project or a start of release. We'll maybe try and gauge the size of that, and that might be in duration, effort, or cost. We might estimate features or epics, and we often do this in story points or t-shirt sizes. Stories, we can estimate in story points or other measures. Story points are fairly common. And if stories are broken down into tasks, often they'll be estimated in hours. So for the purpose of today, I'm largely going to be talking about stories. So stories and story points. And why do we estimate? How is that useful? No, so you said to know the project release date or forecast release date. Why is that? Why do we do that? So why is that useful? Make commitments? Okay, so order the backlog. So we have to make some decisions, right? So estimation gives us information. Information with uncertainty, but it gives us information. Information is useless unless it is used to make decisions, right? What's the purpose of having information if it is not going to influence any kind of decision? So that's why, you know, yes, it's used for forecasting, but what decision is that going to influence? If we have to do something because it is so vastly important that the cost doesn't matter, then estimates don't matter in that case. So why do we estimate? What kind of decisions do estimates drive? Do we start something at all? Do we even begin? Knowing how big something is may help answer that, make that decision. What should we work on next? What priority of things? Should we stop work and work on something else? Maybe we have some new information going through, or as we start working on something and realize that maybe we need to stop this now that we have more information and work on something else. That's a very valid decision. Should we swarm or add more resources, more people to something? Should we get help in other ways? Should we split something into smaller segments of value? Should we reevaluate our technical approach? And so these are all types of decisions that estimates may help us make. Right. Yeah. Absolutely. So help make compromises. So yes, estimates help give you an idea of cost, so therefore, how do we make compromises? And I think that goes kind of to priority and in all of these questions here. So I think it was Woody Zuhl either coined or promoted the term no estimates, the hashtag no estimates. And there's others like Vasco Duarte, who was at the conference last year, who's written a book on no estimates. And it's getting a lot of kind of popularity on Twitter these days and heated debates. So Woody describes no estimates as the hashtag for the topic of exploring alternatives to estimates of time, effort, or cost for making decisions in software development. That is, ways to make decisions without no estimates, without our traditional approach to estimates. So it's acknowledging that, yes, we have decisions to make. What are those decisions? And are there alternative ways we can make those decisions differently than we've done in the past for estimating? So one approach suggested by no estimates, this no estimates movement, is stop estimating story points. Stop it, just stop doing it, and instead simply count the number of stories per iteration, throughput. So why would you want to do that? Well, what are we trying to do with story point estimates? We're trying to get a forecast, right? When are we going to forecast a release? Do we need to make some of these hard trade-off decisions? How do we prioritize things? So if we have another metric, another number that can help us do that just as well, then that could potentially work. So the idea is if we just use story count, the suggestion is that is actually just as good, if not better, than using story points. Now, this has been quite the religious war on Twitter. And do we have any like data scientists in the room? Okay, a few. All right. So they'll be happy we actually decided to collect some data. And it's not big data, unfortunately, but it is some data. And so what you'll see next is some charts and graphs. But we actually wanted to see, is this true? Can you just use story points? Does that make any, is that any better or worse than using story count instead of story points? So we collected some real and analyzed some real data. We got data, it was provided by Vasco, who from 55 projects across 9 different companies, 37 projects came from one organization. So yeah, we understand that it's from one organization, but if you look at the data even across organizations and within an organization, it's all very consistent. And the data is openly available. You can go to the website and you can download the spreadsheet yourself and run your own analysis and write a paper on it if you wish. A couple quick definitions before we get started. So velocity, I'm defining as instantaneous velocity is story points delivered in a specific iteration. Average is the average story points delivered across all of iterations over a period of time. Throughput is the number of stories delivered in an iteration, and average would be average number of stories delivered over all iterations. So why are estimates useful? Well, we talked about making decisions to stop something, start something, reprioritize something, get help. And one useful tool we have for doing that is the release burn-up or cumulative flow diagram. And so if we use story points on it, it looks something like this. And so what we've done is we've normalized time and we've normalized scopes. You'll see it goes from 0 to 1 and 0 to 1. So we can compare all projects on the same scale. And what you'll see here is these projects, essentially the burn-up chart from beginning till completion for 3 projects out of the several dozen we had. And so this is a burn-up chart, and you can see actually all of these, or 50% of the projects actually had this kind of 2 to 12% hardening phase at the end, which suggests they might have been doing water scrum fall a little bit. So that things slowed down at the end, velocity lowered. So now the question is well, wait a second, if we're trying to produce a burn-up chart to forecast, if we just count the number of stories, does that produce something that works just as good? So the first thing we did is just, let's just overlay it over top. So same projects, blue is story points and green is story count. And from the very beginning, we can kind of see that, hey, there might actually be some correlation here. Story count might do something that's pretty similar. We might be able to generate burn-ups from just story count. So before we delve further into the numbers, I just want to introduce the idea of the P90 to P10 ratio. And we use this a lot, and I come from energy, so we use this a lot in petroleum engineering and measuring the amount of oil in the ground. So P90 is your 90% confidence, right? You're 90% confident that you're going to meet that deadline. So 10% confidence means you're only 10% confident you're going to meet that deadline. So for example, if your P10 is 6 months, that means you're 10% confident you're going to meet that project date of 6 months. And if you're 90%, that means you're 90% confident that you'll get it done in 12 months or less. Now the ratio of these two is this P90 to P10 ratio, and it'll give you a gauge of kind of your variance, right? So if you've got a large ratio, P90 to P10, that means from the most optimistic to kind of the most pessimistic, there's a 2x gap. So in this case, for this project, it would be 2. So we actually use this P90 to P10 ratio to look at some of the numbers in the data. So the question we wanted to answer, one of the questions was, do we get better at estimating the further we go in a project? Another way of stating this is, does our velocity become more stable over time? Okay, we say some people said velocity becomes more stable over time. If the variables remain the same, okay. So we've got some. I think we've got some people who believe that we can, and this is a very common belief that we get better at estimating. We understand more. We can make velocity more and more stable. So let's actually look at the data. We look at all these different projects to see, hey, did any of them actually get better at estimating over time? And we discovered that they don't. And you can see here, this the blue line is the P90, the green line is the P10. And if you take that ratio, they start off with this ratio of 4, which isn't really great to start with. That's like 4 times difference between your P90 and your P10. And over the course of lots of these projects, if you kind of average it out, it actually tended to get worse. This is an interesting discovery. Velocity predictability does not get better over time, or that's what the data is suggesting to us anyways. So we have to think about, well, why that might be, and we'll get to that later. So next question that we use with the data is, if we just use the throughput, so the story count, to forecast completion, is it any more or less accurate than using velocity story points? So if we want to look at our burn up and forecast into the future, if we had just taken the story count, is it any better or worse than if we use story points? So we looked at the data again, and what you can see here is this bottom line here of throughput versus velocity. Because it's close to 1, it's basically saying that regardless of which one you use, they're giving you similar forecasts for a release date on a burn-up. So with the data we have, this suggests that actually story count would be pretty much just as good. So next, we decided to do a simulation. So we did a Monte Carlo simulation. We simulated 1,000 projects. Each project had 50 story points. So if you're not familiar with Monte Carlo, it's basically you get the computer to simulate it, and generate random variables and randomly generate the size of stories and their actuals versus estimates, and run a project in the computer and see how it works out. And we were able to vary certain variables to see how they impacted the results. So we varied the story point distribution. That was one thing we changed or experimented with. So in some cases, all the stories were very near in size. In other cases, there was lots of small stories and lots of big stories, and we investigated how that might impact the results. We also changed the estimation accuracy, so we experimented with, okay, well, let's assume some teams are better at estimating than other teams. Does that make a difference? We also experimented with the bucketing approach, right? We have different ways of bucketing story points. You can use Fibonacci 1, 2, 3, 5, 8. You can use powers of 2, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16. So do any of these help? Do they make things better or worse? And then we also looked at this hardening effort at the end to see what difference that made. So what did we learn from this? The first thing we learned is we actually can run a computer simulation that gives us results that are fairly similar to the ones that were collected. You can create probability distributions for your stories and your story size distributions that actually give you numbers that you can kind of see here in these lines at the bottom that fairly closely replicate what we saw in the data we collected. So what are some other outcomes of the simulation results? We found that there was fundamentally no difference between velocity and throughput projections. I think there was only about a 6% difference between them. Now there were cases where velocity showed an improvement over throughput when not an entirely big surprise, but if story point distribution was very large, if I've got massive stories and some little stories and they're all mixed together, then having some kind of determiner between big stories and small stories, big surprise, does happen to prove estimation or improve predictability. And also, if the team was good at doing estimation, then like really good at doing estimation, that can help. Changing the buckets didn't really make much of a difference. So whether you do Fibonacci, powers of 2, or even power of 4, didn't significantly impact the simulation. Sorry, how many? Yeah, so if we use powers of 4, like it's 1, 4, 16, like there's large. when story point distribution was large. So when there's, yeah, when there's big stories that actually, multiple orders of, so the analogy is estimating mixed nuts. If you have a bowl of mixed nuts and they're all roughly the same size, then the exact size of them doesn't really matter that much. However, it does make a difference if you've got big coconuts, you know, mixed in the bowl, which isn't really a terribly surprising conclusion. So what does this tell us about estimation? So what kind of conclusions or what kind of things can we take away from this? When it comes to decisions that steer us towards the release, velocity and throughput are equally good and bad predictors. They both have flaws, but they're also about equivalent in being able to produce results, provided that all your stories are roughly the same size to start with. And then you could get in this argument, well, if they all roughly have to be the same size to start with, then isn't that a form of estimating? And probably yes. But the idea that you can actually use that, and you can actually just use throughput, provided your stories are the same size. So what other decisions? Decisions to help with managing iterations. Okay, I've got a question. How many people use, like, decompose stories into tasks? And, okay, most of the room. How many people do task estimates and estimate in hours? Okay, so majority again. What decision does that drive? How is that information used? Okay, so whether you can fit that story into that iteration. Okay. Any other reasons? To generate the That's not a decision, right? That's this graph, right? So you generate the graph. So how is that? Okay. So what decision does that drive? Okay. Okay. So the story might not get completed in that iteration. So what decision are you going to make with that information? Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. So I heard a decision there. If two ones have similar priorities, this information might help us choose one if it costs less. So I'm trying to get the idea of, like, how are we using this information? What decision is being driven by that information? And so when it comes to task estimates, and you're doing burndowns like this, which are this is an interesting one. Because look, progress, and then everything kind of gets delivered. All the story points actually get delivered on the last day. But this is actually, like, I've looked at lots of teams within our own company, and this is surprisingly common. It's not like you get what you measure, right? So if you get this, if you want this perfectly linear burn down, you'll sooner or later get it. But that's not the same thing as delivering stories, right? So that's actually pretty. So delivering tasks isn't the same thing as delivering stories. So what does this tell us about estimation at the project sanction level, at the start of a project? Well, some level of macro estimation of costs is probably likely necessary in order to make business. What did I do? There we go. Is likely necessary to make business decisions, right? The company probably wants to have some idea of how big or small something is. But the risk is that we potentially could spend more time on cost estimation than the benefits that estimation provides. As we saw, we see this in the data, because there's a large degree of variance in the estimate. And so if you spend lots and lots of time trying to get, more and more accurate, more and more precise estimating, you actually can waste a lot of time and for not a lot of benefits. So if you're looking at kind of your project portfolio management and you've got this idea generator, and then you know ideas kind of get rejected out of the filter, and then as you go along, some projects get canceled in progress, and you know that's okay too. And then you know finally some of them hopefully make it through this filter into operations. So throughout this pipeline, estimates are useful in making this decision making throughout the pipeline. But how can we use our knowledge of this variance in estimates to make sure that we're not making decisions on false precision? And so how did these results compare to other research that's been done on this? So there's actually been a few studies done over the years on software and software estimates and the accuracy of these estimates. And so I'll just review some of them and show how these results compare to others. The one I'm aware of is Landmark Graphics. And so in this case, there's plotted, this is an actual versus estimate plot. So actual on the vertical and estimate on the bottom. And so if we have perfect estimation, all of the points will lie along this this 45 degree angle line, right? We are perfectly accurate. Estimates are always equal to actuals, regardless of the size of the story. And so we collected data, this study collected data from Landmark Graphics, which is a company, and this shows you the distribution of actuals versus estimates. So I believe this line here is actually like the 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, so this is like the 4x line. And then there's another study by DeMarco, and you can see that's the red points there, which had largely similar results. So what's this showing us is that how many of these points are actually grouped along this ideal line, and how varied are they? You know, some of these stories up here were, I think, order 6x what their estimates were. All right, so how about some other research? So this is done from Steve McConnell, and it's in his book. And in this case, he's got its perfect accuracy line. It's the same chart, but just another study. And on average, the target was 22 days, but the actual delivery was on the order of 56 days. And he measured this in days here. So very consistent results. These ones here were done in time, like they were actually measured and estimated, and so yeah, these ones were measured and estimated in time. The story point estimating in Scrum basically compensates for systemic errors in your estimation. Like if you assume that, okay, we're going to be wrong, but all our stories are roughly going to be wrong by a factor of 2. Well, once we start measuring velocity, well, that factor of 2, now we've measured of what that factor is and when you can forecast out, right? So that's how Scrum gets around that. So here's a histogram of the actual versus originals. So I think only 10 to 20% of the stories were in the 1x category, like within, really close to their estimates. 50% were 2x or less. So only half the stories were under 2x their estimates. And then 80 to 90% of the stories fell in the P90 interval. So that's saying 80 to 90% of your stories, you actually have to go out to a 4x your original estimate to actually collect the 90% of 90% of your stories for, which is a huge, it was actually a fairly huge range. I mean, that's basically saying if you've got if you estimate a project's going to take 1 month, 4 months, yeah. So if you do 100 projects and you estimate all of them to be 1 month, you know, lots of them are going to take up to 3 or 4 months. Or you have to go at least that far out to collect the collect 90 of them. Has anybody heard of this study from Jorgensen? Am I pronouncing that correctly? In 2013, this was a really interesting one. So they actually got research funding, and so they put a software development project on bid on the, there's this online marketplace, VWorker. So they actually said, hey, we want someone to build us this piece of software. We want companies to bid on it. And they had, I think they had fairly well-defined requirements, so it was very clear what needed to be built. They received 16 bids from these companies. The companies didn't know this was a research project. They think this is, you know, real, honest-to-goodness work. They reduced down to the 6 bids with the highest online rankings, so people thought these were good companies from their previous work. And then the 6 bidders went on to actually build the software. So they actually paid all 6 companies to build exactly the same thing. And none of these companies knew the other companies were doing it. And they didn't know they were part of a research experiment. And so they were trying to see, okay, well, what was the variance in the actuals versus estimates? And so the highest estimate was 8 times the lowest. The actual versus estimate range was somewhere between 0.9 to 3. So the best, you know, the best team came in at, you know, 70% what their estimates were. The worst team came in at three times their estimate. And then if you actually just compare the actual performance, like how was the fastest team overall to produce the product versus the worst team, the fastest team got it done 18 times faster than the worst team. I think this one's really interesting. It just shows like the huge, huge variance when it comes to both software productivity and estimation. No, this won't show you if there's a correlation between if you're good at estimating and actually good at delivering the software. I don't know if they actually have that information in the study. I'd have to go back and look, but it is an interesting question. Does that mean if you're really good at estimating, were you actually good at delivering? I don't know. I have to go back and see. Because this was a different study. This wasn't us. But we're just looking at how does our results compare to this? And I think it's largely consistent. And here's another study that shows, or I think it's more data to show this estimation ratio over time. Do we get better at estimating over time? And you can see largely this graph is consistent over time. It's basically showing your actuals versus estimates. And as you go through the length of a project, you're just as bad at estimating as you are at the beginning. So this is a big surprising discovery, right? You know, I think if we started off at the beginning, people saying, oh, yeah, well, as we go through, we're going to get better at estimating. Our velocity can get more predictable. Why is it that that's not the case? Why does the data not seem to show that? Well, if you think about it, oh, there's the 4 times line there, right? If you think about it, it kind of makes sense. If you look at the invest criteria, we want independent user stories, stories that will be independent of all the other user stories. That means each user story kind of has its own degree of uncertainty. So if here's all our different stories here, well, if I work on this one, it's going to be different than I work on these ones. And so we get, you know, 2 stories done, 3 stories done, 4 stories done. But each of these, because each of these stories is independent, they have independent risk. So it really shouldn't be any surprise that as we go through, we have we don't actually get any better at estimating. So for everybody who said at the beginning that it's a major portion of your job to either estimate or deliver on your own estimates or someone else's estimates, are you all worried now? Are you screwed? So now the question is, now what can you do? I think there's lots of data from, you know, this study and the previous ones I mentioned that show that there is a large degree of uncertainty in our estimation. So what can we do about it? And one model to look at this is the Kneffen framework that Dave Snowden popularized. And he's got this idea of we can have simple projects. And if you look at your actuals versus estimates, you'll have like a very narrow, thin line. This is what people want to see in software projects. We have a high degree of certainty. There's no risk or distribution of variation. And sometimes these projects come about, things that are very simple, well-defined. More often than not, we have something that is at least complicated, where you get some kind of, you know, uncertainty, there's some kind of distribution. And sometimes that can be narrower, sometimes that can be wider. And then you go into the complex terrain where you have, you know, a very long tail. There's lots of risk and lots of risk. Lots of things that can go horribly, horribly wrong. And that's where you need a complex mechanism, which, you know, Scrum provides, honestly, to iterate over. And then chaotic is just all over the map. I think the major thing is understanding what category you're in. You can't apply methodologies that require a high degree of certainty if you are in a complex domain. Waterfall requires a high degree of certainty because you're creating all these dependencies, the sequence of events that have to be followed in order. You basically need to be working on a simple project for that to work effectively. Waterfall requires a lot of predictability. So step one, know what domain your project is in. The other technique, which Todd Little has often talks about, which I think is a effective one, is once we know how bad estimates can be, or what that range is, that up to four times, well, so much about software is managing expectations. So why would we say that, you know, we can get this scope of work done, or create the expectation that this amount of scope of work can get done, when we know that there's a good chance, because of uncertainty, we can only get about 50% of that, or 25% of that. So his method, instead of using Moscow, you know, must, you know, could, should, familiar with that? We must have this, we could use this. Well, what happens if you don't deliver on a, you know, a should? It's not a must, it's just a should, but if you don't deliver on a should, you feel bad. It's bad, you know, we should have had this in here, but you didn't deliver on it. So his approach is using ABCs instead. So A's are all musts. Those are things that we have created an expectation for, we have created commitments for, and it must be completed to ship the product. And the product owner knows that they are aware that they will slip the shipment date to make all the A's, right? It's so important that they've made the conscious decision, they will move the release date in order to make all the A's. B is now wished. We wish to have it in. Sounds much nicer than should. It's a wish to have it in, but it's not an expectation. And C, it's not targeted. And only A features are committed. And if you devote more than 50% of the planned effort is allocated to A things, the project's at risk. Consider that. Don't commit more than 50% of your planned scope. Don't create the expectation of getting more than 50%. So, you know, if this is our target delivery date here, 50% of that time we're creating that expectation that, okay, we're fairly confident we can get these A's in, and then the rest of the time, you know, we wish to have them in, and then maybe some like lower priority things. And then what'll happen is, oftentimes because of uncertainty, we'll actually deliver just A's, right? That one times estimate turns into a four times actual, and what happens is you get nothing but A's delivered, and that's okay. But because we managed expectations throughout, this is a perfectly normal thing to happen. We still got the most important things done, but we've now hopefully improved trust with our customers by not creating false expectations and a false sense of precision. So in conclusion, the original question was to estimate or not to estimate. Going back to some more Shakespeare, the answer that I think we've come up with is that there's not one's not right nor the other. You can use story points, you can use throughput. They both have their benefits, they both have some costs, they're in many ways very similar. But know what it is you're doing and why. So instead of, you know, let's try to avoid a lot of these religious debates that go on about estimates versus not estimates, have a deep understanding of what decisions we're needing to make. Let's be honest with ourselves about how accurate estimates really are, and accept that there is a large degree of uncertainty and risk in software development, because without risk, we really wouldn't be creating any value. And the software development teams can't be alone in accepting all that risk. You know, we talk about partnerships and working together with the business. This has to be a shared risk in product development and discovery. So, and I'm missing my last slide apparently. Right, I had some contact information, which isn't there, but those aren't even my kids. I'm borrowing this laptop. Yeah, no, I've got my own kids. I don't need any more. The information that's available is the paper that has much more information I talked about today is available on Todd Little's website, as well as this presentation. And it's toddlittleweb.com. He's easy to find. So you can review that paper. You can get the data, the raw data, and you can do your own analysis and draw your own conclusions. And we are easy to find on Twitter and LinkedIn and all that kinds of things if you have any further questions. All right. Thank you for the time, and I think we have a few moments left to ask maybe one or two quick questions. Yes. Yep. So the question is, if I understand correctly, make an estimate and find out it's wrong because there were some assumptions made at the beginning, right? So what do we do about it? Do we just say we don't bother estimating at all, or do we... Right. So I think that's what I personally like about that is you're communicating some degree of confidence. It's some degree of confidence or risk, right? I like to encourage teams to do that when they do have to have these conversations. It's not just give me the one number. It's we're fairly confident we can have it something by this date, less confident by that date. I think that having that conversation around risk and uncertainty and getting our partners and our customers thinking along those lines, I've found that to be helpful. Keep in mind, a lot of the work I do is internal applications within our company. The other thing is we are going to be wrong. We are going to be wrong, and we are going to be wrong a lot, and that's okay. It's just, okay, now that we're going to be wrong on small scales, and then let's find out about it and iterate over it. So if it takes, a day or an iteration in a day vice like an iteration minus 2 days, then that'll happen from time to time. I don't think that's the end of the world, but are we able to get the feedback and use that's I think that's the main thing is we're talking about empirical process control and getting those feedback cycles. So I think one more question. And that's a terrific point. I mean, what's the Eisenhower quote? Plans are useless, but planning is essential. And even within our own teams and our company, when we asked the question, why do you estimate? They came up with the same point. It's like, it is a mechanism for helping us explore the problem space. We get information out of simply going through the activities, which you're absolutely right, isn't represented in this data at all. Yeah. One more question. I won't say anything conclusively because I don't remember the exact numbers, but I'll say somewhat tentatively based on what I remember of looking at the data is that, yeah, the bigger things get, the less certain it is. Like there is a benefit to seeming to break things down smaller, that, you know, that four times uncertainty goes to something, you know, larger when you get to bigger things. And I think it goes back to the breaking things down, that activity helps us explore the problem space better. But there's a cost trade-off to that. How much time do you spend doing that? In this case, small project, you can spend more time wasted in estimating when you could just actually start work, potentially. All right, thank you everyone, appreciate it.